गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। शकुंतला, शैल वी स्टार्ट?
यस मैम, ए वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू एवरीवन फॉर टुडेज वेबिनार एंटाइटल्ड विथ नैनो साइंस एंड नैनो टेक्नोलॉजी ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फिजिक्स शारदा विलास कॉलेज मैसूरू। आई एम शकुंतला, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर एंड हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ जुआलॉजी। आई रिक्वेस्ट ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स टू गो थ्रू फ्यू इंस्ट्रक्शंस। Only 100 participants can watch this session through Google Meet, and rest of the participants can watch the live session through YouTube link. The link is already given in the invitation message. Mute your audio and turn off your camera throughout the webinar. Don't click the present now option because that may interrupt the audio and video of the presenter. Use the chat box for any queries or communication for ongoing webinars. The link for feedback form will be shared in the chat box and also to the WhatsApp group during the concluding part of the webinar, and certificates will be issued only to those participants who fill it and send it on time. Nanoscience and nanotechnology is the branch of science that studies systems and manipulates matter on atomic, molecular and supramolecular scales. Nanotechnology is being used in a range of energy areas to improve efficiency and cost effectiveness. I know all are very excited to know more about the nanoscience and nanotechnology. So let's start the session. I request Srimati Spooti B.S., Assistant Professor, Department of Physics, to welcome the gathering.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Spooti, Assistant Professor in Physics, Sharda Vilas College, Mysore. It's my great pleasure to welcome you all to this webinar. First of all, I extend a warm welcome to our President, Dr. B.M. Subraya, and Sri N. Chandrasekhar, Honorable Secretary, Sharda Vilas Education Institution, Mysore. I welcome our beloved Principal, Dr. M. Devika, to this webinar. Welcome you, ma'am. I heartily welcome our resource person, Dr. N. R. Pawar, IQSC Coordinator and HOD of Physics, Arts, Commerce and Science College, Maregaon Road, Yavatmal District, Maharashtra. Welcome you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
I heartily welcome Subandhi S. Singh, IQSC Coordinator and HOD of Physics, Sharda Vilas College, Mysore. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you.
I welcome all the participants who have joined this webinar. Welcome all. And at last, not but the least, I welcome all my dear colleagues and my dear students to this webinar. Welcome each and everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your warm welcome. Now I request Srimati Sugandhi S. Singh, Associate Professor and Head of the Department of Physics, to introduce our guest to the program.
Good morning to everyone. I'm Sugandhi S. Singh, Associate Professor and Head of Physics Department, Sharda Vilas College. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce our resource person, Dr. N. R. Pawar, for today's webinar. Dr. Pawar is presently working as Head and Department of Physics at Arts, Commerce and Science College, Yavatmal District, Maharashtra. Dr. Pawar was awarded a national award called as Dr. T.K. Saxena Memorial Award in 2015, and in 2019 he was awarded Maharashtra Gaurav Puraskar for excellence work in various fields. The Department of Science and Technology, DST and CSIR, New Delhi, Indian government sanctioned foreign travel grants to Dr. Pawar to visit various countries. Dr. Pawar is a PhD supervisor recognized from RTM Nagpur University. He has many research publications to his credit. He has published 71 in international and national journals, 15 in international conferences, 29 in national conferences, and many more. He was the chairman for many international conferences as a technical session leader. He is a PhD examiner at NIMS University, Jaipur. He is a life member of various fields in physics. To name a few, life member of Ultrasonic Society of India, life member of Acoustic Society of India, and many more. He was a resource person for various international symposiums and conferences. He is the convener of International Conference on Recent Advances in Material Science and Nanotechnology, called as Raman 2021. National Testing Agencies, MHRD, Government of India, appointed him as an observer for conducting UGC NET for 2 times and JEE main observer 3 times. Since time is a barrier here to list all his achievements, this is a brief introduction of Dr. Pawar. Welcome you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am, for a nice introduction.
Thank you, everyone.
Over to Shakuntala. Honorable Dr. B.M. Subraya, President of SVEI. Respected Sri N. Chandrasekhar, Secretary of SVEI. Respected Dr. Devika M., Principal of the College. Respected Professor Singh, Head Department of Physics, SVC. All the excellencies, dignitaries, participants, research scholar, teaching, non-teaching staff, and dear student. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Suganti Singh ma'am for inviting me as a resource person for today's webinar. Also honor to respected principal, faculty member of Department of Physics of this college. I express my sincere gratitude towards organizing team. Once again, thanks to all. I am going to deliver talk on the topic nanoscience and nanotechnology.
Sir, sorry for the interruption. Our principal will give no issues. Okay, sir. Please continue, sir.
Once again, a very good morning to all. I am going to deliver a talk on the topic nanoscience and nanotechnology. As we reduce the size of the material to its nano size, then there is enhancement in the properties of the nanomaterial. And this is the beauty of the nanomaterial and the nanotechnology. These are the contents of my talk: nanoscale, nanomaterials, nanoscience, nanotechnology, history of nanotechnology, factor that causes on the properties of the nanomaterial, top-down and bottom-up approach in nanotechnology, and various methods for the synthesis of the nanomaterial and their characterization, especially here XRD, FTR, SAME, TAME, and other characterizations. Nanofluids, this is my one of the research area, stability of the nanofluid, applications, and the motivation for research to especially BSc student. Nanoscale, it is used to refer to objects with a dimension on the order of 1 to 100 nanometer. Nanomaterials, the particles of metal, semiconductors, and insulator with size in the range of 1 to 100 nanometer, at least in one of the 3 dimensions, that is the length, breadth, and thickness. The nanomaterials can be broadly divided according to their degree of confinement. One-dimension nanomaterials are nanowires, nanorods, nanotubes. Two-dimensions nanomaterials are graphene, nanoplates, nanospheres, and zero-dimension, especially the quantum dot. That is, no dimension are larger than 100 nanometers are included in zero-dimension, that is a quantum dot. Nanospheres, nanoparticles are the examples of the zero dimension nanoparticle. this is a one dimension nanoparticle, two dimension, this is the carbon nanotube, and this is the graphene, and this is a nanoparticle. Comparison of size of nanoparticle, this is the size of our laptop, 0.1 to 1 meter, micro channel 100 micrometer to 1 millimeter, bacteria are in the range of 1 micrometer to 10 micrometer, viruses are in the range of 10 nanometer to 100 nanometer, small molecules are in the range of 0.1 nanometer to 1 nanometer, and our nanoparticles are in the range of 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer. That is a 10 to the power minus 9 meter. Nanoscience, it is an emerging area of science which involves the study of material at the nanoscale. Nanotechnology, it is the technology developed by the researchers, or the researcher develop and apply material at nanoscale to develop new product or method. That is turning nanostructures into usable tools and the applications or the products. It is a technology of design, fabrication, and applications of nanostructure material. Nanotechnology is likely to have a profound impact on our economy and society in the early 21st century, comparable to that of semiconductor technology, information technology, or cellular and molecular biology. Nanotechnology involves the manufacturing and applications of instruments and materials that have unique properties because of their small size. Researchers are using these unique properties of material at this small scale to create new and existing tools and products in all areas of science and engineering. We can, especially for students, these are the nanoparticles, and these are the nanowire, and these are the so many products in that we use the nanotechnology. Nanoparticle, that is converted into nanoscience and the nanotechnology. History of nanotechnology. Professor R. Feynman from California Institute of Technology delivered a first talk in 1959 in the session of American Physical Society related to the product of nano-sized material from atoms and the molecules. The word nanotechnology was introduced for the first time into a scientific word by N. Taniguchi from Tokyo in 1974. In the second half of 1918s and early 1919s, a number of important discoveries and inventions was made. In 2000, the Japanese Economic Association organized a special department on nanotechnology. In 2001, the National Nanotechnological Initiative, that is NNI, of the USA was approved. Recently, nanotechnology research began in the CIS countries, usually with the framework of state scientific program. Nanotechnology is not new. Gold nanoparticles in glass are reflected as a red. As we know, gold is a yellow in color, but when it is inserted in a glass tube, it is reflected as a red. In ancient times, stained glass maker know that when we put finely gold or silver nanoparticle in the glass, or simply the particle, because at that time they don't know what is a nanoparticle. Finally, gold or silver in the glass, they would get beautiful color. They use nano-sized gold and silver particles since optical property changes with the nanoscale. And they design the number of products like this. And all these are designed on the basis of the nanoscience and the nanotechnology in 17th century. So the nanotechnology is not new. Gold and silver nanoparticles were used as a pigments to attain color in glass in 17th century. The cup exhibits red color when lit from behind and green when seen in reflected light from the front side. And this is the beauty of the nanotechnology, because when we reduce the size of the material, to its narrow range, then there is a large enhancement in the property of the material as compared to that bulk material. Nowadays, there is a nanotechnology in everywhere. These are the number of products, and all these products are based on the nanotechnology. Factors cause the properties of nanomaterial. At nanoscale, the properties of material are very much different from those at a large scale. Two principal factors cause on the properties of the nanomaterials are increased relative surface area, and second is the quantum confinement effect. When we reduce the size of the material, then the number of particles comes on the surface, and hence there is enhancement in the surface area. And similarly, what is the quantum confinement effect? There is a restrictions of the electron, and so there should be the possibility change, there should be the change in the optical properties of the nanomaterial. These two factors can enhance properties of nanomaterial, such as the reactivity, strength, and electrical characteristics. And like that, this is an example of carbon nanotube. Carbon nanotube, and all these are the carbon nanotube. Carbon nanotube conduct heat and electricity and show great tensile strength. Nowadays, we use this carbon nanotube in your bike. Carbon nanotube reduces the noise, increase the strength, increase the durability, and also increase the mileage of your vehicle. What is the size effect? Size effect of nanomaterials. Just here we have discussed, when we reduce the size of the material, then the surface area will be increased. If we consider this is a cube, surface area equal to length into breadth into the number of faces, and volume is a side cube, that is A cube, if we consider A as a side. Now here, sides are 3, 1, 2, 3, surface area equal to 3 into 3 into number of faces, that is 6, equal to 54. And volume equal to 3 cube, that is 27. Then what is the surface area? Surface area upon volume ratio equal to 54 by 2 equal to 2. If we consider this, then here the sides are 2. Surface area equal to 2 into 2 into 6, that is 24. And volume is a 2 cube, that is 8. Then surface area upon volume equal to what? 24 by 8, that is 3. Now here the surface area to volume ratio increases as compared to in first case. Similarly, if we consider side is 1, surface area equal to 1 into 1 into 6, that is 6, and volume is 1, then the ratio of surface area upon volume is 6. So here we conclude that when we reduce the size of the material, then the surface area upon volume ratio goes on increase, and this is responsible for the enhancement in the optical, magnetic, and other properties of the nanomaterial as compared to that bulk material. Nanomaterials have a relatively larger surface area when compared to the same volume or mass of the material produced in a larger range form. We consider a cube having side equal to 1 meter, then collective surface area equal to 6 meters square. When we reduce the size of that into 0.1 meter, then area is 60 meters square. Similarly, 0.01 meter area will be increased, and 1 mm area is 6,000 meters square, and it is reduced in the nano range, that is each side equal to 1 nanometer, then the number of cubes equal to 10 to the power 27, and the area will be 6,000 kilometer square. And this is responsible for increase in the properties of the nanomaterial, enhancement in the properties of the nanomaterial, increase the strength of the nanomaterial. Similarly, there is one of the example, if we consider a cube of 1 meter, then surface area equal to what? That is 1 cube, 1 meter square. If we reduce the side of the cube into 10 nanometer, then surface area equal to 600 meters square, that equivalent to the 6 running tracks having length equal to 100 meter. So we imagine what is the beauty of the nanoscience and the nanotechnology. What is the beauty of the nanomaterial? When we reduce that into side of 10 nanometer, then there is a large enhancement in the surface area of the material. And so the number of nanoparticles comes on the surface and taking part into the interaction. Surface area, increased surface area of nanomaterials, if we consider the nanomaterial in a spherical shape, then its surface area equal to 4 pi r square, volume equal to 4 by 3 pi r cube, then what here? 3 by r, and so the surface area upon volume is inversely proportional to its radius, that is the size. And hence, we reduce the surface area because radius or the size in the denominator. When we reduce the size of the material, the surface area upon volume is inversely proportional to that. That is, there is enhancement in the properties of the nanomaterial. And second part, which is responsible for the enhancement in the properties of the nanomaterial, that is the quantum confinement. As the particle size decreases, the electron become more confined in the particle. As a result, valence band, it is a filled orbital, and conduction band, it is an empty orbital, break into quantized energy level. When the atomic orbitals of nanoparticle become discrete, or that is quantized, quantum confinement occur. Quantum confinement is the restriction of electron movement. Quantum confinement is achieved when electrons remain below the Fermi energy. And this quantum confinement makes it possible to fabricate material with a tunable electric and optical property, which can result in the development of new devices. And so this is the beauty of the nanomaterial. Now here, the surface, increase in surface area and the quantum confinement are responsible for the enhancement in the properties of the nanomaterial. These two factors play very important role. And now what are the properties of the nanomaterials? And just here we have discussed the mechanical property, improve hardness, toughness of metal, alloys and all. Magnetic property, increase magnetic cohesivity after a critical grain size, super paramagnetic behavior and all. Electrical properties, increase in electrical conductivity, optical properties, spectral shift of optical absorption and fluorescence properties, increase quantum efficiency of semiconductor nanocrystal, catalytic properties, nanomaterial act as a catalyst to enhance the rate of chemical reactions and vapor deposition process. And these are the properties of the nanomaterial. Now, top-down and bottom-up approach in nanotechnology. Top-down approach. Here, a large material converted into the nanomaterials. Now, what here? The nanoscale objects are made from larger objects. Integrated circuit fabrications is an example for top-down nanotechnology. Lithography is the technology which has enabled making tiny chips. In some applications, larger scale materials are grinded to the nanometer scale by using number of techniques. And now here, the large material having in the range of 100 micrometer that can be converted into the 10 nanometer. This is a top-down approach. Similarly, on the bottom-up approach, what here? A very small materials, 0.01 nanometer, that can be converted into the 100 nanometer. Now, what here? Making larger nanostructure from smaller building blocks such as the atoms and molecules. Manufacturing of carbon nanotube using metal catalyzed polymerization method is a good example of bottom-up approach nanotechnology. There are so many techniques for the synthesis of the nanomaterial. These are the physical techniques, that is bulk millings, thermal evaporations, lithography, vapor phases. These are the chemical techniques and the biological in bacteria, fungi, yeast, and we can extract from the plant directly the nanoparticle. We are in a Yavatmal district. We are in a specifically in Chandrapur districts, and there is a number of open mines. We can extract the nanoparticle from the mine waste. 98% of the nanoparticles are available in the waste, and the coal mines is nothing but the biomass, that is a fossil fuel. And so we can extract similarly from the plant nanomaterial by biological method, and it is an eco-friendly method for the synthesis of the nanomaterial. Chemical methods for nanoparticle synthesis: co-precipitation, sol-gel processing, microemulsions, hydrothermal, solvothermal synthesis, chemical vapor decompositions, and like that. We have synthesized some nanoparticles by using a sol-gel technologies. Sol stands for solutions and gel for gel. A solution converted into the gel by a number of chemical process. What here solution converted into the, this is the solutions, okay, mixture that can be converted into the gel. Now gel is a dried and converted into the powder form, and the nanoparticle we can easily form because this is a very simple and the cheaper method for the synthesis of the nanomaterial. So we have synthesized the nanomaterial by using sol-gel technique. We also synthesize the number of eco-friendly method, that is the biological method, just like a silver nanoparticle and all. Sol-gel processing, the chemical solution converted into an integrated network, that is called a gel. Now here, it includes the hydrolysis and the condensation. Metal oxides and metal chlorides are typically undergo hydrolysis and the polycondensation reaction. Hydrolysis and the condensation reaction. And generating metal oxygen metal bond, that is a metal oxygen metal silicon oxygen silicon bond, or metal hydroxide metal, that is a metal OH metal polymers in solution. After a drying process, the liquid phase is removed from the gel. Then by thermal treatment, that is a calcination, enhance the mechanical properties of the synthesized nanomaterial. And this is a rub diagram solution converted into the gel that we use in our laboratory, and drifted into the gel that is grinding in powder form and sifting as per our requirement. We have considered only the synthesis of one nanoparticle. We have synthesized the alpha alumina nanoparticle. Alpha alumina nanoparticles, nanoparticles of alpha alumina, that is alpha Al2O3, was prepared by sol-gel technique from aluminium isoperoxide and aluminium nitrate. Starting solution was prepared by adding aluminium isopropoxides and gradually in 0.2 mole aluminium nitrate and solution continuously stirred for 48 hours. Later sodium dodecyclobenzene sulfonate SDBS was added and stirred for 1 hour. Now this solution were heated up to 60 degrees Celsius and stirred constantly for evaporation process. The paste so often was heated at 90 degrees for 8 hours. We get nanoparticles of alpha alumina in powder form. Similarly, we have synthesized the silicon carbide. There are so many applications of this nanoparticle. And we have synthesized the boron nitride nanoparticles. Boehmite nanoparticle, there are so many applications of this Boehmite nanoparticles. And we have synthesized the silver nanoparticle by thermal decomposition method and also by the eco-friendly method directly from the extraction of the plant. And now we have synthesized the number of nanoparticle, okay? And what are the characterizations technique? That is for analysis of the nanoparticle. There are so many techniques for the analysis of the nanoparticle, and especially the powder X-ray diffraction, that is XRD, Raman spectroscopy, UV visible, scanning electron microscope, that is the same, transmission electron microscope, that is the TEM, atomic force microscopy, that is AFM. Out of these, the spectroscopy based techniques, XRD, Raman and UV visible are considered as the indirect method. Same TEM, AFM are considered as a direct method for determining surface morphology, crystalline size and surface topography of the nanomaterial. Study from that we obtain the grain size of that nanomaterial, its thickness, crystalline phase, from Raman spectroscopy, composition and interactions between the molecules or the constituent, UV visible to determine the band gap using absorption spectra. Now this is the XRD, this is the X-ray diffractometer. XRD is a non-destructive technique used to analyze the structure of crystalline materials. It is the way of the study of the crystal structure. It is used to identify the crystalline phases present in a material and thereby reveal chemical composition information. The X-ray diffraction pattern of the powder sample of nanoparticles were recorded by XRD. X-ray diffractometer. The average crystalline size has been calculated by using a Debye-Scherer formula, and the formula is like this. Here lambda stands for the wavelength of X-rays, and B is the full width of half maximum, that is FWHM, and theta stands for the Bragg's angle of radiance. And we can calculate the approximate grain size of the synthesize a nanoparticle. Generally, the XRD pattern of single crystal specimen, these are the single crystal specimen. The nature of the XRD pattern is like this. This is the XRD pattern of polycrystal specimen. If there is a polycrystal specimen, then the XRD pattern is like this. XRD pattern of amorphous or the liquid specimen. If we find the XRD of the liquid material, then the XRD pattern is like this. And this is the typical XRD pattern of the gas molecule. Now, what is a B? In previous slide we discussed, we can find the average grain size of the synthesized nanomaterial by using Scherer formula. In that, what is a B? This B is half width, okay? And this B equal to half of what? 2 times of this theta 1 minus 2 times of this theta 2. That 2 get cancelled, then B equal to theta 1 minus theta 2. Theta 1 minus theta 2, and that is a B. Substituting this value in that formula, we can easily calculate the grain size of the synthesized nanomaterial. And this is the XRD pattern of the synthesized alpha alumina. We have compared this XRD pattern. This is my sample. We have synthesized this nanomaterial, alpha alumina nanomaterial, and we have compared this XRD pattern with the standard data. XRD pattern of alpha alumina nanoparticle that is given in JCPDS file number 71127. It is observed that both patterns are exactly matched, and so our synthesized alpha alumina is suitable for the further study. It is seen that the alpha alumina nanoparticle is well crystalline in nature, and the estimate size of alpha alumina nanoparticle using a Scherer formula is found about 20 to 30 nanometer. Similarly, this is the XRD pattern of the SiC silicon carbide nanoparticle. It is also in good agreement with the standard data given in a JCPDS file number 029-1129. And the particle size of the synthesized silicon carbide nanoparticle is found about 50 nanometer. Similarly, the XRD pattern of this Boehmic nanoparticle, it is also the close agreement with the standard data. This is the XRD pattern of the boron nitride nanoparticle, and it is also in good agreements with the standard data. And like that, we have synthesized the number of nanoparticles. This is the synthesized silver nanoparticle. This is the XRD pattern. It is also in good agreements with the standard data. CaCO3, it is also good agreement with the standard data. Now, how can we find the grain size? Now, we consider this, okay, maximum peak here, okay? This is the data, okay? And from that, we can find the grain size. Now the XRD refinement, by knowing this, these values, okay, These we represent, so we use the maximum peaks. We consider here the width of that, and the data can be insert in the XRD refinement crystallographic refinement software. Then we get the value of H, K, and L. And we know very well because we are the we have the background of the solid state fitting, and we know the H, K, and L. What is H, K, and L? I will not waste time here. Now, second characterizations, that is FTIR. FTIR is a techniques used to obtain an infrared spectrum of absorption or emission of nanoparticle. It simultaneously collects high spectral resolution data over a wide spectral range. Now, in my case, FTIR spectra were recorded by using Perkin Elmer. Here, this is the XRD FTIR spectra of the Goldschmidt nanoparticle. It is in close agreements with the standard data. And we know the absorption peak observed here and a very weak band at this is attributed due to the symmetrical stretching vibrations of the nitrogen-oxygen bond, which might have come from the nitrate of the starting material, and the spectrum shows a peak at 735.47 centimeter inverse, which is due to the aluminium oxygen bond vibrations in the spinel block alumina structure. And similarly, this is the FTIR of alpha alumina. Here again, what it is also the in close agreements with the standard data. I will not take here time. This is the FTIR or the silicon carbide. It is also in close agreements with the standard data, boron nitride, and similarly the same. Same, it is a technique, spectroscopic characterizations, and especially the same. And this is these are the same images of the alpha alumina. It is a technique that produces images of a sample by scanning the surface with a focus beam of electron. The electron interact with atom in the samples, producing a various signals that contain informations about the surface topography. The crystallines looks like having a shape, surface edge, as well as crystalline grains, and the particles foam like. These are the foam, these are the same images of the silicon carbide nanoparticle. Here also the foam like morphology. And this is the same images of boron nitride nanoparticle. Here also the foam like morphology. And now we have synthesized the materials, nanoparticles, by using the Sol-gel techniques and the number of techniques. Now, this is a part of my research. The synthesized nanoparticle can be converted into the nanofuel by dispersing it in the base fuel like methanol, ethanol, and like that. And so, now here again, there are number of characterizations of the number of analysis techniques of the synthesized nanoparticle. A TAME not shown here, TAME, and this is a from the TAME, we can confirm the particle size confirmations. For particle size confirmation, we use this analysis. And for the elemental analysis, we use the EDS, that is energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy. And these images are not shown here because of the time restriction. And these are the so many instruments by using that. This is the X-ray diffractometer. This is the Raman spectroscopy, electron microscope. That is a scanning electron microscope. That is the same. Then this is a high resolving of the same, and this is a Beckman spectrometer for UV, and the transmission electron microscope, that is a TAME. Again, these are some images of the AFM, that is atomic force microscopy, and this play very important role to understood the surface morphology, surface interactions, especially the physical interactions between the constituent. And now we have synthesized the nanoparticles and analyzed, characterized the nanoparticle. Now this nanoparticle can be converted into the nanofluid by using two-step method. What is the two-step method? In the first step, we have synthesized the nanomaterial, and this nanomaterial disperses into the nanofluid, disperses into the base fluid like methanol and the ethanol. And these are the number of the nanoparticles, and these are the number of the base fluid, and these nanoparticles are dispersed in the base fluid that can be converted into the nanofluid. And so it is called a two-step method, because in the first step we have synthesized the nanoparticle, and the synthesized nanoparticle disperses into the base fluid by using magnetic stirrer, ultrasonications, and by using number of techniques. Now in my case, we use the two-step method for the synthesis of the nanofluid. It is the most widely used method for preparing the nanofluid. Nanoparticles are first produced as a dry powder by chemical or the physical method. Then the nano-sized powder will be dispersed into a fluid in the second processing step with the help of intensive magnetic forces, agitation, ultrasonic agitation, high shear mixing, homogenating, and ball milling. Due to high surface area and the surface activity, nanoparticles have the tendency to aggregate. The important techniques to enhance the stability of nanoparticle fluid is the use of surfactants. To avoid these aggregations of the nanoparticle, we use the surfactants. One-step method is not suitable for the synthesis of the nanomaterial, because the process in this method, the process of drying, storage, transmission, and dispersion of nanoparticle are avoided. And so there is agglomerations of nanoparticle in this one-step method. The one-step process can prepare uniformly dispersed nanoparticle, and the particle can be stably suspended in the base fluid. However, there are some disadvantages for one-step method. The most important one is that the residual reactants are left in the nanofluid due to the incomplete reactions or stabilization. And this is a very simple technique my student used in my laboratory for the synthesis of the nanofluid. Nanofluids of nanoparticle are produced in base fluid by two-step method using a magnetic stirrer for 30 minutes. In some cases, if the results are not good, we use the ultrasonications for the synthesis of the nanofluid. The mixture is subjected to microwave heating till the reaction is completed, and the color of the mixture may change. The obtained product is the nanofluid, and this is a magnetic stirrer. We have synthesized the nanofluid. Again, we have the same images of these synthesized nanofluid. In first case, we have the same images of the synthesized nanoparticle. Now here, the same images of alpha alumina nanofluid in methanol. Now it is observed that there will be the large changes in the same images of the nanofluid and the nanoparticle. Same images show the good dispersion of alpha particle, nanoparticle, alpha alumina nanoparticle in base fluid. It is important for qualitative analysis. Similarly, the same images of the Boehmic nanoparticle, and these are also the, there is a large difference in these nanofluid same images as compared to that Boehmic nanoparticle. Here also, the same images show the large dispersions of nanoparticle in the base fluid. And again, we find the particle size of the nanofluid by using this ultrasonic techniques or acoustic techniques. We find this intermolecular radius, okay, by using these parameters. We can easily find out these ultrasonic thermoacoustic parameters and substituting the values, and we can find the particle size of the nanofluid. Okay. And it is observed that there is a large changes in the size of the nanofluids and the nanomaterial, and hence we conclude that the synthesized nanofluid is okay for the research study. Now, stability of the nanofluid. We have synthesized the nanofluid. The stability of the nanofluid very important role for the enhancement in the properties of the nanofluid. Especially, I am talking about the thermal conductivity. Now, some parameters play very important role for the enhancements in the stability of the nanofluid. One of them is the Brown in motion, and second is the zeta potential. Brown in motion, it is the erratic random motion of nanoparticle in a fluid as a continuous bombardment from molecule of the surrounding medium. It is a key mechanism governing the thermal behavior of nanoparticle fluid suspension. It enhances the effective thermal conductivity of nanofluid. And this is the Brown in motions of the nanoparticle. Zeta potential play very important role for the stability of the nanofluid. It is the potential difference across the phase boundaries between solid and the liquid. It is a measure of the electrical charge of particles that are suspended in the liquid. It is a measure the stability of the dispersions of foam due to the reactions. And now here we observe this boundary, and this is the zeta potential. And this is the zeta potential analyzer. We can measure the zeta potential of the nanofluid. In my case, we measure the zeta potential of SiC silicon carbide nanofluid in methanol. It is observed that the zeta potential has a larger value for the molar concentrations 0.7, and I think second is 0.7 and the 0.9. Okay, 0.7 and 0.8 has a larger zeta potential in positive and the negative value. If the zeta potential has a more than plus 30 or the minus 30, then the stability of that nanofluid is good. The positive or the negative values of the zeta potential are necessary to ensure the stability of the nanofluid. It is used to avoid the aggregation of nanoparticle in nanofluid by varying the stabilizer concentrations or by surface modification. It is a measure of magnitude of charges on nanoparticle. Normally, the higher values, either positive or the negative, more than 30, indicates the good stability of the nanofluid. It is observed that zeta potential, in my case, for 0.7 molar concentration, has a higher value, indicating more stability of the nanofluid. Moreover, it has a less value for other molar concentration, indicating less stability. This is the zeta potential for the Voigt-Mitte nanoparticle. Here also, the maximum value, the values for more than 30 positive and more than 30 negative means what? There is a more stability of the nanofluid. So we can obtain the stability of the nanofluid by using zeta potential, and we use that stable solution for the study of the nanofluid. Thermal conductivity play very important role, because this property of the nanofluid play very important role. We may use this nanofluid as a coolant, because we use the traditional coolant, copper and the water. And if we replace that by the nanocoolant, nanofluid coolant, or especially the nanofluid, especially the iron nanofluid, then what happens? There should be the enhancement in the mileage of our vehicle. There should be the enhancement in the durability of the vehicle. And there should be the possibility of the reduce in the noise of the instrument. So nowadays, thermal conductivity play a very important role. We may reduce the size of our aeroplane by using the thermal conductivity, and it plays a very important role. Now, I will not take much time. In my laboratory, the result, this is, we measure the thermal conductivity of the Voigt-Mitte nanoparticle, Voigt-Mitte nanofluid in methanol. The result clearly shows that the effective thermal conductivity of nanofluid increases with temperature. As temperature increases, the thermal conductivity increases. And this is a good result. This is a very good result in thermal conductivity. If it is increases with respect to the temperature, definite, it may use as a coolant. It may use for the power generation. You may use this in a power station for a various purpose. The thermal conductivity enhancement are highly dependent on the specific surface area of nanoparticle, weight, and optimal surface area for the highest thermal conductivity. There is a strong relationship between the Brown in motions and the temperature of nanoparticle. The Brown motion also affect on the thermal conductivity of the nanoparticle. Now we measure the thermal conductivity. We can verify the thermal conductivity theoretically by measuring the sound velocity of the synthesized nanofluid. We measure the sound velocity by using this instrument, and this is a. In that case, we measure the sound velocity and the sound velocity of the number of synthesized nanoparticles, and it is observed that by measuring the sound velocity, we compute the number of thermoacoustic parameters, and we find the thermal conductivity theoretically, it is seen that it is in good agreements with the experimental value of the thermal conductivity. So we conclude that the synthesized nanofluid is good for the research. Now these are the advantages of the nanofluid: high specific surface area and therefore more heat transfer surface between the particles and the fluid, high dispersion stability with a predominant Brownian motion of particle, reduced pumping power as compared to pure liquid, or to achieve equivalent heat transfer intensification, reduced particle clogging as compared to conventional slurry, thus promoting system miniaturization, adjustable properties including thermal conductivity and surface weight ability by varying particle concentration to suit different applications. These are some applications: thermodynamical study of the nanofluid applicable in power plant, especially I am talking about the thermal conductivity. A study of nanofluid could be used to provide cooling and lubrication actions and control thermophysical and biochemical properties of material processing in drugs delivery system, because colloidal form of drugs are easily absorbed by the body tissue and hence are more effective. Industrial cooling and nuclear system cooling. These are some conclusions. Enhancement in thermal conductivity is due to the stability of nanoparticle in nanofluid. Nanofluids have high thermal conductivities and heat transfer coefficients compared to those of conventional fluid, especially that is in, I am talking about the copper and the water. Nanofluids properties make them suitable for the next generation of fluid and heat transfer fluid. Pioneering nanofluid research has inspired physicists, chemists and engineers around the world. And what is the future work related to the nanofluid? The stability of the nanofluid is to be studied more compressively. The effect of the type of dispersing agents on the properties of the nanofluid is to be studied. The nanofluid prepared by two-step method is to be applied to heat transfer system to find out the enhancement in the heat transfer rates. And these are some applications of the nanomaterials in nano lead strip, nano robot, and nano chip. Then nano medicines, because nowadays the nano medicines are available in the market, okay, and these are more effective as compared to our traditional medicines, because the molecules in the traditional medicines are in the micro form, but the nano medicines, the molecules are in the form of in nano, that is 10 to the power minus 9 meter. Nano lenses, nano diamond batteries, and there are number of lot of applications of the nanomaterials. Nanomaterials also applicable in reticuloendothelial system for the cleanage, and here the nanoparticles play very important role for the cleanage process. And now the lot of applications of the nanoscience and the nanotechnology in nanobiology, metrology, sensor, electronics and materials. Nanobiology, that is the diagnosis, tissue engineering, drugs discovery, drugs delivery, aerospace, cosmetic, surface coating, printing, catalysis, energy, and like that, the number of applications of the nanomaterials and the nanotechnology. Now, just for a BSc student, the innovations and the motivations for research. Hope the students of the Singh Madam, Professor Singh Madam, will jump into the research.
Yes, now, yes sir.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
please guide them, sir. Please guide them, sir.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Just I will take 5 to 10 minutes, ma'am. Okay.
No problem, sir. No problem.
Okay,
no problem.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Because the time restrictions, okay. I have covered the number of things. Okay, ma'am. And now, what is the nano pollution? We are talking about the nano pollution. In our country, there is air pollution, soil pollution, and the air, after then water pollution. There are so many types of the pollution, light pollution, and like that. But nobody talking about the nano pollution. Some of the nanoparticle, mostly carbon compounds, enter into the body, cause damage of the blood tissue. Especially talking about the mines area, coal mines area. When nanoparticles get into the body, they accumulate in the fatty plaque, causing heart attack and strokes. Gold nanoparticle forms contractions of blood vessels. Silver nanoparticle, when encountered in the soil, it can kill beneficial bacteria. Nanoparticle can have the same dimension as biological molecules such as a protein. And so this the nanoparticle easily combines with the biological molecule. People are unknown from the nano waste. Most of the human-made nanoparticles do not appear in nature. When these nanoparticles, I'm talking about the carbon nanoparticles, when enter into our body, then what happen? They cause the damage of the blood vessel. There is a contractions of the blood vessel, and there is a possibility to cause the heart attack. We don't have BP, we don't have sugar, but due to the nanoparticle, there is a possibility to cause the heart attack. But in US government, the US government spent $710 million in millions in 2002 on nanotechnology research, and out of that, the $5 lakh was spent on environmental effect, that is to control the nanopollution. But in our country, we know the situations about the pollution. Careful planning of new research is required to establish the true impact of nanoparticle on the environment. So we may think about the nanopollution in our area. But by using a nanoparticle synthesized eco-friendly, we can overcome the soil pollution, water pollution, air pollution, and like that. Second type of pollution, that is the noise pollution. If noise level is of 90 dB of continuous period, can cause the loss of hearing. Completely loss of hearing. Average noise level has been found to be between 65 to 90 dB. The noise level to double its present value for every 6 years. Noise level above 50 dB can cause the cardiovascular problem. In a restaurant, the noise is about, noise pollution is about, or especially the noise is a 55 dB, busy road 75 dB, classroom 35 dB, laboratory 45 dB. And so, what here? We don't have awareness about the noise pollution. The noise pollution may damage our complete health. And this we have introduced here from my research in the field of acoustics. Air pollution, everybody know about the air pollution. Out of the top polluted cities, about 21 cities from the India. Delhi, world's most polluted city. And this is a published news, what year given, the dangerous metal causing cancer in Delhi air, that is a Greenpeace. Due to air pollution, 2,500 people may die every day in 2014. What is our future of India? Put on your own oxygen mask first. not only the human being, for animal also. Again, now dangerous metal causing cancer in Delhi air, that is a Greenpeace. There is a fast pollution, air pollution in Delhi. And due to air pollution again, 2,500 people may die every day by in 2014. This is the reports, okay. Now what is the light pollution? This is our traditional lamp. This is the CFL and this is the LED. In our traditional lamp, there is a what? There is a electron-electron interactions, but in LED, there is a photon-photon interaction. Because in the sunlight, or in sunlight consists of the photon, and sunlight is eco-friendly. Now what here? In our traditional lamp, heat will be liberated, and that can be generate the carbon dioxide in the surrounding. In CFL, there CFL consists of the mercury. It is the most toxic to the human being and the living organism. Mixture of argon and the mercury produces the ultraviolet radiations when the gas is excited by the electricity. And these UV radiations are very harmful to the living organism. And the mercury also the harmful. So I request to all, go eco-friendly, because LED is eco-friendly. We are the physicist and we know the photon-photon interactions that is related with directly the sunlight. Now here the electron-electron interactions, that is the metal interactions. Now here the eco-friendly interactions. And we also consume our electricity, because only the 15% electricity is required if we replace our traditional and the CFL lamp by your LED. And 20% electricity is required for the lighting in our country, in the whole world. And these are the LED, because we replace your CFL and the traditional lamp by LED and go eco-friendly, because it is a photon-photon interactions in the LED. Now, just in previous slide, we know we reduce the 85% electricity by using the LED. We can reduce the 100% electricity by using the wall LED. These are the wall LED, and there is no need of electricity. We need only the battery of the 6 volt. And we can decorate your home walls like that by using the wall LED. Okay, 6 volt battery only. And there is no need of electricity, and hope everybody will go eco-friendly by using the LED. And now what here? This is the Whirlpool washing machine. And there is a 3 rods in this washing machine. The Whirlpool washing machine has a 3 rods. There is a 3 rods. And this technology adopted from village woman washing clothes on a stone. Very simple concept. And now this is under copyright. Okay. Now there is a 3 rod, and these 3 rod play very important role, like that the village woman washing clothes on the stone. And these are the 3 TVs. Okay. Now what here? The Videocon, Samsung and Sony. I am not interested to comment on any on, but what here? If we check the components and the conclusions in all these, then what here? The components are the same, designing is also the same, and the same materials are used for the designing or the for producing of the all these TV. But what here? The cost price of Videocon is 50,000, Samsung 55,000, and the Sony 60,000. Why? Because of the Sony achieve reputations and truthful credibility in the market. And so request to all BSc student, try to being an ideal human being, because it is required for the ideal society. And now these are the number of the capacitors, and these are used for the military purpose, for designings of the satellites. And some of them are the capacitors, because which are used in for the satellite communication purpose. And in satellite communications, we use the material having constant density with various temperature. It is impossible. And so we adopt the technology of the Japan, because the Japanese scientists synthesize the material having constant density at various temperature, it is impossible. And we use that material for the satellite communication. And these are some references. And this is a memory of my national award, Best Research Award in 2014 for excellent, innovative and the novel research. And this is an award from the government of Maharashtra, Maharashtra Gaurav Award for excellent work in educational field. And I acknowledge, acknowledge to Professor Suganti Singh ma'am for inviting me, HOD Department of Physics, SVC. This is my research group, two students awarded PhD, three students are in working in my laboratory, and synopsis of three students is a ready, and total my 121 publications, national awards, state level award, best oral presentation award 7, foreign travel grant by DST and DST and the CSIR 3, visited country, and like that. Now, thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you so much, sir. It was very informative and useful session for us. The students are much enlightened with your talk, sir. Now the session is open for queries. Any questions or clarifications in this topic, participants can post it in the chat box. Otherwise, you can unmute yourself and ask the speaker.
You may send your queries directly to my email address.
Okay, sir. Any questions from the participants?
For any queries regarding to the synthesis of the nanoparticle, for their characterization, you may contact with me. You may contact with Singh ma'am, okay? And hope she will convey your message to me.
Sure, sir. If they I will convey the messages which has been forwarded to me to you, sir. Sure, sir.
Any questions? If there are no more questions, we can conclude the session. I request Mr. Pratap Yamar, Assistant Professor, Department of Physics, to present a vote of thanks.
Pratap,
please unmute yourself.
Okay. Sorry for the inconvenience. Starting by a quote by our former president, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, sir, the teachers have a great mission to ignite the minds of the young. So myself, Pratap MR, Assistant Professor, Department of Physics, SVC, it's a great honor for me to have the opportunity to thank everyone in this special day. I thank our resource person of today, Dr. N.R. Pawar, for taking out time from their busy schedule and enlightening us his knowledge on nanoscience and nanotechnology. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Expressing my sincere gratitude to our President, Dr. B.M. Subraya, and Honorable Secretary, Sri Chandrasekhar N., SPEI. Thank you, sirs. I would also like to thank our beloved principal, Dr. Devika M, for encouraging for this webinar. Thank you, ma'am. I would like to express my hearty gratitude to Srimati Sugandhi S. Singh, head of the Department of Physics, for the support and encouragement. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank the technical support headed by Dr. Jagdish Krishna for a YouTube live stream without any lag. I also thank Srimati Shakuntala, the anchor woman of this event and the head of the Department of Zoology. Thank you. Hearty congratulations to all the organizing team and my dear colleagues from the department. Active participation is the key thing for any event to be a success. I finally thank all the participants who took part in this webinar. I thank each and everyone for making this webinar a successful. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
Pratap. Thank you, ma'am. Once again, I am grateful for inviting me. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you on behalf of Sharda for accepting our invitation and having enlightened our students and faculty members. My heartfelt thanks to you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Wish you the same.
Thank you.
And have a good day.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Bye. Good day.
Thank you, sir. The link for the feedback form will be shared in the chat box and also to the WhatsApp group. I hope this session was very informative. Thank you, everyone, for joining.